For the Twin Peaks panel. Where are you guys from? Where at?
20 minutes away.
Anybody? 20 minutes? I know we got people from out of state. Sacramento? Okay. Portland?
Vancouver,
Canada? Okay, so people came. All right. My name is Brian Lintz from CultClassicPosters.com. My booth is self-plug all the way at the end of Artist Alley. Lots of Twin Peaks art to get to have these guys sign. We're going to get the panel going. This is Steve.
Hey, howdy, y'all. I'm an actor-director in Seattle, obviously a Twin Peaks geek, or I wouldn't be up here. And I work for a convention there called Crypticon, and a couple years ago I tried to buy Laura Palmer's house. That's me.
And I'm sure I don't need to introduce these guys, but I will. Sherilyn, Fenn, James Marshall, Kimmy Robertson, and Harry Goaz. Cast of Twin Peaks. So, kind of to get things started, I wanted to ask you guys, are you currently still under NDAs for anything, season three or otherwise?
Kind of. Some of them, yeah. Some things, yes.
Okay, so is that a confirmation there's going to be a season four?
Yeah, because they tell me all that stuff.
Yeah, I know. Before I know, a lot of people have got questions probably about the return, and tomorrow the panel at 2 p.m. is audience Q&A. So I think today we're going to do a little bit about the original series, season three, and a little bit more about like the craft of acting. So I want to start off, Harry, since you're kind of newer in the convention scene, right? Haven't done too many shows, and not a lot of people have heard the story. Can you kind of walk us through and tell us like how your meeting with David happened and what led you to Andy Brennan?
I was working two jobs, and I was studying method with Paul Traylor, and one night I got a call to pick up Mr. Lynch and drive him to the Roy Orbison Memorial. Drove him to that glorious thing, and I thought, well, you know, I'm just going to wait for him. So I can't even believe that I let the car sit there. I just sat there in the car, and when he came out, he was shocked. I was sitting there, and he got back in the car, and we talked and talked and talked, and he cast me that night. So that's the very abbreviated story.
All right. Kimmy, question for you. For me, I wrote all these down because, by the way, as you cannot tell, I'm not a professional panel presenter. I'm an artist. But I'm a Twin Peaks geek, so they got me to do this. Kimmy, for me, Lucy was always the one that held the sheriff station together. She seemed to simultaneously have all the details of systems worked out, yet she had an airy, dreamlike quality about her. Can you tell us about who Lucy is and how you kind of found her as a character?
Nope.
Okay. All right, well, that's going to be shorter.
I know that David Lynch told me that Lucy is not an airhead. She's not a bubblehead, is what he used, the word bubble. And that she knows what's going on in the whole town and the office, and it's her mission to keep everybody organized and on time, and make sure there's enough donuts, and the coffee's always fresh, the pot always had to be full, and that got to be a struggle in the second season. I was always fighting with those prop people. They just didn't want to do it the right way. It's a human nature is to absolutely want to do everything wrong. And one day, it's weird, but I may have wandered off topic here. But one day was the show after we were in the woods writing on the chalkboard possible suspects when Harry, Andy was standing by the bottle, and Agent Cooper hit the bottle with the rock, throwing scene. And we were back in the office, I assume it was that day later or the next day, and Lucy, I thought, should be reading a book on Tibet, because Agent Cooper had just told everybody all of this stuff. So she has to get up to speed, and I said that to the prop person, and he was like, no, she doesn't want to know about Tibet, and you can't have a book on Tibet. And I said, all I need is a book, like one of these big books here. There was all these ledgers, and just write Tibet. And he said, no. And so I said, give me a Sharpie. I found a Sharpie, and he saw me starting to write in my perfect penmanship. Tibet, and he grabbed it away from me, and right then David Lynch walked on. He was directing that episode, and he said, what's going on? We need to shoot in 2 minutes. And I said, well, I just thought Lucy would be reading a book on Tibet today. And he said, well, absolutely, obviously. And he looks at the prop person and says, so where is it? And he goes, we don't have one. And he goes, well, make one. And I handed him the Sharpie and the big ledger. And David Lynch said, that'll work perfectly. And he said, but you have 2 minutes to do it. He brought it back in 2 minutes with a picture and everything. Did that answer your question?
Sure, absolutely, yeah. And more. That's a question for James. To me, your character, probably one of the most misunderstood in the entire series, especially with some of the crazy adventures you take in season 2 with Evelyn Marsh and all that stuff happens. We had talked once before, and you'd mentioned there was a scene that was filmed but never aired that kind of might give a little bit more context to your character about your mother. And I wonder if you could give us just like even a brief what that was about.
The NDA question thing is kind of, it's like a constant thing usually with the NDA is a official thing, but we're really not supposed to. I was telling you last night too, because I could talk about it a little bit, but I'm not going to go into too much detail because it's like they, I don't know anything about a fourth season. That's honest from my heart. But should anybody want to ever do anything with anything, they do have footage from stuff and they do have things they might want to use. So I don't want to like say too much about it, but there's a lot that went on behind James's stuff that people didn't get to see, such as his mother. She was an extremely dynamic person as far as like negatively dynamic. So it was like, he comes from basically a lot of neglect and abuse and all this strange stuff. So I won't go into like some of the imagery, which we were talking about, which is really cool, but there were scenes written or there's scenes shot with the mom and all this stuff. So there's this whole kind of other thing that James went through that nobody really saw that I do think would have added some stuff. Yeah. So, but I don't know. I mean, because I wish I could tell you guys, like, it's really cool imagery and really cool stuff he did. But this was in the original. So yeah, this was in the original series. And just as they went back, spoiler time, I guess I shouldn't say it, huh? Just for people who haven't seen it. But, yeah, but
you're not
in the new series, there's some things where, they sort of explain stuff through showing you other stuff from, other stuff. So I don't want to say anything, So, yeah. So it's like an NDA that's constant, sort of, if you have respect for the situation, which sometimes I screw up. So I hope, I'm trying not to desperately. What?
Do they know?
Oh, the NDA agreement is a non-disclosure agreement that we had to sign, for just that we're not allowed to talk.
Will they sue you?
Yeah, are they really hang you up? So, but yeah.
Well, I hope someday. I mean, we waited forever for the firewalk with the deleted scenes to make the light of day. So I hope, against hope, that maybe eventually someday, because I know there were so many things that we've seen scripts of or there's been video clips of of scenes that were shot from the original series and never aired. You know, I hope someday maybe we get to see those things.
Yeah, me too.
Sherilyn, to me, during you played this great transition in Audrey from kind of this troubled girl seeking her father's attention, and then into kind of fixing that relationship with her father, and almost in a way fixing her father too. And as that season kind of came to a close, your relationship was mending. He wanted to be good, and then we found out that he was the biological father of Donna. And I wonder if that was something that you had ever thought about, if season 3 had happened at that time, how that revelation might have affected Audrey's relationship with Ben, or her moving forward, being that they had just kind of gotten back together.
Well, I've never even thought of that, to be really honest.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
It's okay. I just don't have anything exciting to say. I don't think that she would. I don't think that Audrey would feel that that was out of character for her father. I think it would more depend, if season 3 had come along, how he was going to continue to interact with her or be there for her, or just kind of do that for a little bit and then flake out again. Right. He's a pretty kind of selfish, narcissistic guy.
Did you get the feeling when you were doing, I know it's going back a ways, but at the time when you were doing those scenes where there was that resolution, did you get the feeling that that was a temporary situation, or did you feel like that was, you know, really a mended relationship?
What I'll say is, a story is just a story. I would say that relationship, that the core damage was done, as is done to all of us in the womb to 7 years old. That would produce great abandonment issues, which I have. Great father issues, which I have. You know, I'm just being honest, relationship issues. And I don't think that, I think that Ben is usually driven by some personal agenda. And I think that would take some years to see. I don't know, you know, it's like, great, this is great for now, but it could drop out at any second.
Okay, great, awesome, thank you.
Jump
in some of the
back
you
want to add? Sure. I had kind of an actory question as far as picking the series up again. So obviously you've changed as people over the past 25 years or so. When you came back to your characters, I'm assuming you didn't get a lot of backstory as far as where they'd been for the last 25 years or so. Was it very easy to kind of slip into those shoes again? Like, oh, okay, I know James, I know how this is gonna be, or was it a bit of an adjustment to come back? Because it had to, I'm sure, be a little overwhelming, at least at first.
Is that for all of us?
Oh, yeah, I'd love to hear anyone's take on that.
It's again, yeah, there was stuff that went on that David gave, I think, I don't know what he did with other people, but a few little things with me, and he probably wouldn't want me talking about it, but I guess to say that, yeah, we've been through, it's kind of like when she does that mudra with her hands or whatever, you know, it's almost like we went sort of to this, each one of us sort of took this weird sort of hiatus type thing that wasn't, it was like literally going on half-mast or something is the feeling I had. And then all of a sudden, it's like a cycle, like the way, like when they say when the stars are right or whatever, it's like the stars, you know, it all came back again and everything lined up again and all of a sudden, boom, and then, okay, meditation over, now go live it all again. You know, it feels like almost, it was almost an abstract time period is the only way I could put it. But he did give us some details.
I haven't ever said anything really about this because it's hard for me to think about the time when we were doing the first two seasons, and then the time we did the third season was like all one time in a bubble or circle or an orb in a different on a different planet where Twin Peaks is a real place. And everything else doesn't matter because it's sort of like the last episode where it looked so different and it wasn't all sepia-y, it was stark and gray and beige, kind of like this room. And so naturally you're going to be like, oh, I want to go to that other place. Where, and also being on the set where it's all filled with love all the time and there's no nonsense that isn't for fun, it just, you kind of slip right back into it. Whatever I thought before I slipped back into it was like, it didn't matter, like putting your point shoes on before you are going on stage. You got to put them on, whether it's causes you agony at all or anxiety, you still got to put them on if you're going to dance on point. Now, Harry has a much scarier story.
It was very hard.
Thank you.
A funny thing happened is that all of the fans who I call Sacred Family has somehow kept Twin Peaks alive all these years. Like, all these years. So, you know, we get things on Twitter or different places, and that love is still there. And from, you know, being graced to meet the fans in person, as a few of us in the past few years have started to actually meet you all, and I think for me that added to like the excitement. Wow, we really did something that stood the test of time. We got to be in, you know, the maestro's world, and it touched all of the people and like young generations coming up and saying, oh, you're my favorite character. I'm like, I could have birthed you, you know, it's weird. I have kids, you know, older than you. So when it came back, it was like, I embarrassed myself and screamed in a restaurant and honestly thought, I'll do Twin Peaks and live happily ever after, because I'm really naive. And then for me, as people know, I have a big mouth, so I get in trouble, so here I go. I was having issues with certain things. Some of us were shown pages. These are your pages. This is what you're going to do. And I didn't really understand what was happening, and so I got in trouble about it, and then we got in a fight, and then it was rewritten, and then it wasn't. So I'm so grateful, and I didn't yell about it. I just said, ooh, and then I said, I'm crying throughout, I have to leave. And David was not happy. But I was just being honest. And then he wrote it really good. I mean, it was hell, right? It wasn't Audrey, you know. But it was certainly 25 years later, some of the chaos and like stuff that you're going through and you're getting older and your prison's in your mind and who am I and what are the choices that I've made and why, you know. So it's I think it was real, and maybe revisiting some time when you thought that you were free, but you're still dancing there in a prison. And we all have a prison.
If I can kind of follow up on that, actually, with you, Sherilyn. When you first found out that you were going to be doing the iconic dance again, was it 100% like, yeah, I get to do that again, or was it, oh my God? I mean, your face is telling me, but...
It was like the first time, it was scary. I mean, the first time we got to the set and David said, we're rewriting this scene. The crew, get a cappuccino, go do this. You know, we're rewriting it. Lara, come over here, Sherilyn, and you're dancing. And it was just like, what am I dancing? With who and where? You know, and they wrote this song, and you're just gonna groove. And yeah, I don't really know what happened, but I just tried to connect with it. And yeah, so when this happened, I didn't think it was the same song. I didn't know what it was gonna be. And then You know, it's trippy. You go to abstract world with him. You go to a different place. It's very hypnotic and weird. And walking on there, and the people, and oh my God, it was crazy. But I realized it was just kind of like her fantasy of like maybe when she felt connected, and you know, and yeah.
And just kind of the converse of my other question. After all this time, is David different to be directed by, or is he the same David you knew back then? I mean, Sherilyn told me he switched to American Spirits, but, you know, something more artistic than that, perhaps.
For me, the only difference is that he'll call you through the, or at least when I worked with, yes. So this big thing, Sherilyn, Fenn, come to the set, I have direction.
I'm just like running across the set. What, David, what? You know, wherever you are, you just hear it over this loudspeaker.
So that was the big difference. Everything else was, he was so happy to be there. He was so happy. And he was like, I'm having so much fun. And, you know, this world and these characters. And I personally think that they didn't, like an executive once said, and some of you may have heard me say it, that they went fishing for Barracuda and they caught Jaws. So it wasn't like they didn't know, but once all these years passed, it was like became the deep love for everyone, not only you, but I think even David like was like, wow. Remember when he took us out, Kimmy? He took a few of us women out and he asked, what was your story of you getting the role? What was your, like he was taking back the pieces of something that I don't think he even himself knew. And I think that's when God comes in. Like, we're just vehicles, and like, this thing came through that touched you all, and he was like, whoa, this is excellent, you know? Who knew?
Yeah, but that whole evening then turned into a big expose of my fucked up love life.
It did!
He just kept shaking his head and putting his hand. Oh my God, oh my God. That was embarrassing.
Kind of going back to coming back to things like your dance, James, you reprised your song at the Roadhouse. Were you surprised by that? How did that conversation go?
Again, like with God entering the situation or something, it's like kind of funny because the whole thing with the initial song, it's a long story kind of, but it was the type of thing where David wanted a, it originally started, he saw that I played the guitar on the set, I was always playing to relax or whatever, and he goes, why don't you do a song on the show? And that's how it started. Then Angelo and he ended up writing that song, and we sat down and kind of played it, and then they recorded it. And when they recorded it, I thought I was going in. He told me, bring your guitar, you're going to go in, we're going to record. And I got there that day, and they had already recorded everything except the voice. So it was a little, and I knew I had to sing that falsetto real high. And it was in a kind of a key that I struggle with. So when I had to sing the falsetto in that struggle, there was like a slight kind of pitchy thing that kept happening. And he was like, kind of, what the heck? And I was like, you sure we can't re-record this in a key that's easier from? No, it's solid. We don't have time. It's in there. So, okay. So we hit it. We did it. And I think it really is meant to be because it's like, so it's exactly, I think, what like a 70-year-old kid would be, you know, if he's recording, he's not going to. Some are incredible. But I mean, he's sitting down trying to hit this song. So it's cool. But I thought the remarkable thing was that he had, to answer your question, he called me and said, Do you think you want to do the song? Can we do it or whatever, you know, at the Roadhouse? And I said, wow, that'd be fun, cool. When do we record it? And he's like, we're going to use the same track, which is, I just went, oh, you're not going to give me the shot to, like, you know, come back and kind of get the falsetto right and have it all in key and have it, like, groove, you know. And no, I love the charm of it. And what was cool is that that blew me away. He took that exact same track, and when it plays in the new one, it's like, for some reason, it doesn't irk, at least me, it's still kind of, you know, but when I was able to hear it in a different way, and it was the only thing that changed was the surroundings, you know? So I thought that was a real testimony to his power as a director, you know? He took that exact same track and somehow got you to sort of see it different, you know, or feel it different. So, yeah, that was cool, you know? It was really interesting to do, so, but yeah.
When you had originally recorded the song, You know, and then you're shooting the scene. The backup singers at the time, was it actually Sherilyn and
Lord? Oh, so. Yeah, they went in and actually recorded it.
So it's their voices that we're hearing in
the return. That's really them, yeah. And that's them in the return, too, yeah.
Wow. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Blue Rose Magazine. They're kind of the new day wrapped in plastic. They actually sent me some questions for you guys for the magazine, if that's cool. Okay, Sherilyn, your scenes were very self-contained from the rest of the story. How did you approach your scenes and give so much of yourself to them when there is very little context present?
Well, again, I think it has to do with the way I approach work, which is, you know, it's about the extent to which you're willing to reveal your soul. Like, my imaginary version of how messed up I am isn't nearly as potent as the real version. Do you know what I mean? And, you know, I know none of you are messed up, it's just me, but, you know. I don't have a problem saying it. This is a crazy world, we're all doing the best we can. I was happy, I was scared, I threw it. I ran the gamut, and she's really obviously going through some messed up stuff, especially when she says, you know, I don't know, who am I, and all that. It's crazy. I mean, I just dove in, and I was grateful to have good material, and that's what David gives you. And, you know, the other thing, I can't remember why it came to me, something that somebody was saying, but it's like David will almost live with that thing of, you know, when I believe it's in Japanese culture, when a pot breaks, they fill it with gold, and the more it's broken, the more beautiful it is. That's David. That's David. That's what's beautiful. What you think is your flaw, what you think is ugly, what you're hiding is like, no, that's your gold, because in that is truth and is wisdom and is wonderful things. And society tells us to do the opposite. That's why David is such an anomaly too. He's like doing it really in a different way. You think it's ugly? You think it's ugly? It's not ugly. You know, how do you perceive? Maybe you thinking only this is pretty is ugly. Mm-hmm. So I just, and I feel like he's so abstract, it's hard to go, but you can feel it. And there's something there that's authentic. There's something that's real. That's something that pulls you in, that begs you to look. Because a movie ain't gonna do it. It has to be a self thing. So I was taught that way, and then to meet him, literally at a time when for the first time I walked into an interview and was myself, which was shy and not very communicative, and then he wrote me a role. So that's who he is. It's about truth, and it's not what the world tells you is beautiful.
Right.
Yeah. Harry, Blue Rose Magazine wants to know, you become a hero for NATO and the only person chosen by the firemen to be given information. To you, is this a new side of Andy, or has Andy always been a hero?
Always. Always been.
I say always, but the question's not for me.
Harry, any thoughts?
No.
Harry, any thoughts?
I don't think he was a hero. I think he was always right, because he was so naive and he was so good that everything worked out because he was good. But in the end, I think there was some bravery that emerged because of circumstances. Maybe not inherent in him, but came from somewhere. So he was different in that respect.
Did what had to be done.
One thing. Well, he's a hero because he had the strength to always show who he was and to show his emotions and to show that authentic person. That's a hero.
He's
instead of this
himself.
Yeah, this person that's, you know, trying to act out. That's not real power. Power doesn't behave that way. Authenticity, heart. That's why, that's my interpretation.
What Sherilyn Fenn said.
Because Andy's no Chad.
No.
James, Blue Rose Magazine wants to know, the scene that resonated most with original fans. Oh, we just did that. I already asked that. Okay. Oh, their second part to that, though, was it seemed like James was able to redeem his past with that song. Do you think James has finally found peace?
I don't know. I think he basically is at a place where he's sort of that, yeah. I think that's what kind of comes off, is that even though, kind of like what you were saying about Harry, like being, or rather Andy being just authentically himself, I think James was sort of, he may have started to even go down a strange road, but I think he was, whether it was, again, people who haven't seen it, I won't say, so. But whether it was what has gone on with him or whatever, he's sort of got blasted back to what he originally is, even more so. So he's, yeah, I think he's really, you know, very authentic in that way, and just stays, he just stayed himself to the point where he just, you know, became, like you said, I think there's a piece inherent in how he wrote him this time. He just stayed sort of, just was being, literally, just being, like, you know, not, no expectations, no agenda, and just being, so, yeah.
I had a couple fluffier questions. I'm sure you get asked about it a lot, Harry and Kimmy, but I wanted to ask about shooting the Wally Brando scene. Because in my head, there's like hours of footage of outtakes and people breaking, and any sort of slice of that story of shooting that scene would be lovely.
Well, we all had dinner first, you know, outside. Where by the ruins of the mill, and Michael Cera was saying, I'm kind of nervous, and asking how David shot, and Harry and I said, oh, you're gonna love it, you're gonna just relax, which never works with an actor, and that's a good way to make him get more nervous, and so, comes to the nighttime and we're outside and it's really cold and everybody's shivering. So if he was nervous and shivering, we didn't know because it was so cold. But he said, okay, let's do it. And we did it. And David said, well, I love it. And he came up and said, dude, that was just amazing. You know, right on. Aces. Harry and I were, those smiles were real. Those were real. He was our son. I mean, we want a son like that. And that cool, almost Marlon Brando, but not lilting lyrical to the right, to the up and down, unless there's clouds, whatever he said, that was just so cool.
It was.
I mean, right there, that was a piece of Lucy, to be specific. Don't let my poem mislead you, because if there is clouds, the shadow won't be there, obviously. So, I mean, and then the stuff with the, I don't know. But, so then he goes, well, should we do one more, just in case? And Michael Cera looked at Harry and looked at me like, what does that mean? Because usually on a set, and I've said this before, so sorry for being repetitive, they go, well, that was great. I loved it. So let's do it again. And then take 14. Well, that was great. I really liked it. Let's do it again. And it's like wasting time, and it makes you hate everybody. It's almost like that's where the devil is in that sentence. Let's do it again. So Michael Cera didn't know what he meant when he said, want to do just one more. And I finally said, he really means one more. And so we did one more, and because that was a lot of stuff to remember, mm-hmm. and he made him go really, he said, take your time this time. And, you know, the first one was like, hello, Sheriff Truman. I mean, so he goes, but this time, you know, really take your time. But so Michael Cera thought he was had died and been put in heaven. And because then you get to, as an actor, sort of be in the scene, really, like, and really enjoy it and stretch the time out, and the love gets bigger, and David's smile gets bigger, and it was, the feeling was so neat. And then he came over and he said, well, unfortunately, we gotta do three sentences over so I can get the shot from behind Sheriff Truman's ear. And he said, I'm just gonna have you start and I'll cut you off. So he had him say some, like, one sentence and cut. And he goes, well, that's a wrap. Everybody, Michael Cera is wrapped. And he was like, what the fuck?
Two takes.
Two and a 16th take. Amazing. So that was spectacular. Somebody I know was recently in a car with his wife, and she was talking about how much he enjoyed it and why he wanted to do more if there was ever more, because he had never experienced anything like it. She didn't know that this person knew anything about Twin Peaks or anything. And she said, he heard that, oh, I better not say this. It's a good thing for maybe in the future, like in July, perhaps.
And then the other fluffy question I have. that's fair. This will be a good way to... So, Twin Peaks rejuvenated in no small part due to fan support as well. In a fantasy world where fan support could also bring back another project you've worked on, be it television or film, again, in a fantasy world, which film or television show that you've worked on in the past would you be tickled if they brought another, like, another season of Erie or Indiana?
No, the fans brought the show back. The fans, that's not a fantasy. That was real. And David Lynch directed it because of the fans. That was absolutely 100% the whole reason.
Oh, yes. I'm just saying, if there was another of your projects that you had done that you would want that same fan support for, to bring back, like, say, in a fantasy world, we are all like, I need another Last American Virgin, or...
But it's not a fantasy world. I'm telling you, it's the real world.
Well, in the real world, then.
All right. I was in a movie called The Real World, and then they changed it to Don't Tell Mom the Babysitter's Dead. So I think that, when I would be the president of the QED report.
No.
What?
Me?
Yeah.
Everybody. Oh. The fact that this all came back, I couldn't even imagine. You know, that's the thing, is... I wouldn't even put it there. Sorry, I didn't turn off my thing. But yeah, this is so unique unto David, I think, you know, and I, or another great, like, master, because, I've worked with some really great people, but I think this is his thing, you know. I think I always equate it to Jimi Hendrix. I love Hendrix, but I think if he were alive, Hendrix would put something out, and people would, or Mozart would put something out, and people would respond and everything. And I haven't worked with too many of those, just David, and, you know, so I really can't even imagine. But
so
to answer your question,
Hendrix coming back could be.
That would be my fantasy. Jimi Hendrix coming back and going and watching him. There you go. I couldn't imagine another project. This is so big and beyond anything I could have hoped for, it's, or even thought to have happened, that, you know, that's where it lays, I think, so.
Oh my gosh, so I selfishly say, this show I did called Rude Awakening, which was so much fun, about this alcoholic who got sober but was crazier than ever. And it was one of Showtime's first shows, and I had a great time doing it. It was a comedy workshop, and nothing like this, but yeah, I liked it. It was fun.
Harry.
I would like to do Jason Reimer's figurehead again, and I'd like to see a collaboration between John Neff and my new best friend, Tony Visconti, doing the soundtrack. And that's what I would like more than anything, and for it to be shot in black and white.
Okay, kind of on a, well, not quite on those lines, but are there any, now that Twin Peaks is wrapped for now and we're moving on, are there any projects any of you guys have that are in the pipe that you're excited about, or what's next?
Mm-hmm. For me, there's just one little project that I'm sort of hoping goes good. Film-wise, hopefully, and there's another music thing that I'm attempting. So I'm kind of in the middle of it, so I have no idea, really, other than that.
To be honest, there's two things. This world of conventions is a completely different animal of anything I've ever. That's been very difficult for me to deal with the emotions, and there's been a lot of fake things happening that apparently is part of it. Not the fans.
Yeah, not
I'm
you
talking
guys.
About the promoters.
Yeah.
Not necessarily them. I'm actually speaking of the agents.
The world of it.
The agents that want to make money from the actors. And that, I have to say, I don't like those people. It seems like everything is just fine without them. Again, everybody's happy and doing their stuff, and there's not a bunch of rules. So I've been working on trying to make that more normal by actually sort of telling my agent off. Huge for the mouse to say something, and then I'm writing something because my manager wants me to, because then he doesn't have to do any work.
I have a book coming out, a fine arts book, just from coming from this, there's nothing I would like more than to actually do something with us four in any capacity. And preferably shot in black and white.
Possibility.
I did a reoccurring role in SWAT, which is coming out now. Yay. And I'm shooting a movie in Portland when I leave here. Oh. And I didn't work most of the year, and then all of a sudden things came in the last few months. And I'm doing a role in a new series called Titans. It's just these superhero things, but I'm like a mom. It's great. It's my favorite thing to be, even
moms
in real life. Amen. He said moms are superheroes. So we're all just, plugging along, trying to, find things that inspire us and hopefully that continue to touch, the beautiful people that you all are.
Well, we are out of time for today's panel. Tomorrow will be the audience Q&A, which I'm sure there will probably be some more well-formed questions than what I could possibly have asked you guys. I just have to say, thanks to everybody for coming out today and for supporting UConn and for coming out for these guys. And thank you so much for coming to this show. As I was a 14-year-old boy when I watched the show, and I remember sitting on the floor of my parents' house for the pilot, and the first few notes that came on the screen just transported me to that place. And I've been there for the last 27 years, and I know a lot of recognizable faces out here have too. So thank you so much for coming to this and for doing this with them.
say one more thing. You know, I just want to encourage everybody, because a lot of people have questions about what things mean. And I just want you to know, David, it means what you feel it means. I mean, he really wants to take you on a journey into you. It's not about like most Hollywood films where they wrap up with a little bow and everybody gets what they're doing at the same time. And it's like, ugh. Whereas David, you're hitting your head. What does it mean, you know? But if it touches you, even if it makes you angry, if it, you know, that means something. The bigger the reaction, the more personal the material. He's a highly spiritual man, you know, who goes deep. And like, when I was telling him I was having all these problems, he gleefully said, "Sherilyn, Fenn, you're a mess. You know, you need to meditate." You know, but he likes that, because then you're showing where you are. You can't get out if you don't deal with where you are. So there's no answers. It's just whatever you got. And some of you have had the most profound, amazing, mind-blowing reasons for. I've said, "Oh my God, I never thought of that." Absolutely. It is, because where you can go within yourself is more brilliant. He only wants to take you there. That's all I got.
All right, once again, the cast is Twin Peaks, everybody.
Thank you for watching the panel. Come to the Eugene UConn next year, hopefully.
The UConn.
Yes.
Yes.
Next year. Come see us.
Yes. All of us. Us four.
And maybe more.